Good morning. Good morning. We want to welcome you here today. It's Twin Day here at MGBC.
It's actually triplets.
Triplet Day.
Yes. We didn't even coordinate, but our staff is so unified. Notice we wore the same outfit.
The staff is incredibly
they
unified.
Left me off the group text.
Sorry,
again.
I don't know what happened. You. There was no group text. It just happens.
Sure.
Well, tonight the Imani Malele Children's Choir will be with us at 7 p.m. Invite a friend or a neighbor and come out to join us for this fun and memorable African worship experience this evening. Also, we know that summer schedules are kicking into high gear, but if you're looking for a way to connect as a family and looking for a way to walk with one another in family worship, whether it's worshiping God or serving others as a family, then we have those Forged and Refined Family Edition packets that you can get right out here in the lobby. You can sign up for that, and it's a way that your family can worship together, but also you can earn t-shirts as a family as well when you do that.
And we also have next Sunday evening, June the 2nd, a special night of prayer for our youth and young adults. We'll be meeting in our, we don't know what else to call it besides the grassy plot outside where Pastor Darrell's house used to be. But we have a campfire area there and some picnic tables. So we're going to have a campfire prayer time together next Sunday. And we'll be praying about the upcoming summer events and camp momentum and all the different things that will be coming. So any youth and young adults are welcome to join us next Sunday evening. And I don't have the time down for that, so...
Not 6:30.
Sure. Is it 6:30? Oh, there it is on the screen. So 6:30, we'll join together. And then on June the 9th, Sunday evening, some of you have been asking about those who went to Greece. We were thinking about doing some Sunday school lessons in the future on that, but some of you are really interested in knowing what we learned and what was involved with the Greece trip. So we're going to have a special time on Sunday evening, June 9th at 6 p.m. in the multipurpose room. Just come out if you're interested. And anybody who went to Greece can be a little bit of a reunion together. We'll show some pictures and talk about mainly Paul's missionary journeys and Paul's impact on the church and how just the different things that we learned from that and can pass that on to you. So hopefully you'll be able to join us if you're interested in that. So let's now stand as we have worship together.
There is one salvation, one doorway that leads to life, one redemption, one confession. I believe in the name of Jesus Christ. I believe in the crucifixion. By his blood I have been set free. I believe in the resurrection. Hallelujah, his life is death to me. All praise to God the Father. All praise to Christ the Son. All praise to the Holy Spirit. Our God has overcome. The King who was and is and evermore will be. Jesus' mighty name, I believe. I believe in the hope of heaven. He's preparing a place for me, far beyond what hearts imagine, years have heard or eyes have seen. I believe that the day is coming. He's returning to claim his bride. Light the altar, keep it burning. See the Lamb who arose a roaring light. All praise to God the Father. All praise to Christ the Son. All praise to the Holy Spirit. Our God has know I'll never be ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. How could I ever walk away from the one who saved my life? No, I'll never be ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. How could I ever walk away from the one who saved my life? No, I'll never be ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. How could I ever walk away from the one who saved my life? All praise to God the Father. All praise to Christ the Son. All praise to the Holy Spirit. Our God has overcome. The King who was and is and evermore will be. In Jesus' mighty name I believe. In Jesus' mighty name.
Let's meet and greet each other and make sure you introduce yourself to the people around you.
If I could have the elders please come to the stage, church elders come to the stage, pastoral staff, all those are on the elder board, as well as Steve Mason and Dan Stern. You guys are up here already. Good, good, good. Brant has the microphone there. He's going to need that. Dan and Steve are going to Africa. Good. And nope, there we go. Good.
Hello.
Yeah, we're going to Central African Republic to visit Water for Good in June. They had an opportunity for us to go there. Our employer is a big sponsor of them. We support their, not that there's anybody over there that you look at, but yeah, so the opportunity was there and we were just happy to be able to go. So we get to see what they do, visit some of their wells that they put in place and visit the radio station they have over there. And yeah, be a lot of fun.
Terrific. And this microphone, I'm not sure what's going on. It will.
Okay. Well, you never know what's going to happen with microphones, but we know God is good and in control, and God's going to use these guys as they head off to the CAR, Central African Republic. Dear Lord, we do pray for Steve and Dan as you bless them. With the ability to be able to go on this trip. And I know Water for Good is a near and dear ministry of this church, and many people have participated in giving and supporting that ministry as they seek to build clean water wells in all of these little places in Africa. And we know the Central African Republic is also near and dear to the Caris Fellowship, as we were the fellowship of all the churches in the world to go there many, many years ago and impacted that entire country. And many people have come to the saving faith in Christ as a result. But we also know the country has had its struggles and just has seen its share of war and just different things, famine and all kinds of struggles. But we pray that you'll bless Dan and Steve as they go, that you'll use them to encourage the people there. Thank you so much, too, for Canary Labs and for that business that has a heart to do ministry as well and to impact the world. And so we pray that you'll bless them as well. And just thank you so much for the fact that we can pray for them right now and they can feel that encouragement from the church body as we lay hands on them and as we identify with them and send them out as a church, just as Paul and Barnabas were sent out from the early church in Acts 13 to be missionaries. And so that's why we do this, and why we pray together as a body, as an entire church, that we can be praying for them while they travel. They'll make all of their connections, and that it'll just be a great time. You keep them healthy and just encourage them that you can use them to make a difference in the kingdom of God. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. All right, we'll have the band come up, and we're going to take our offering, have the ushers come up as well. And let's pray together. Dear Lord, thank you so much for this opportunity to give and to be a part of your purpose and plan for your kingdom. And part of that is worshiping you through giving. We pray that you would just bless this offering and bless the giver as well, that as we serve you, we love you, and worship you today, that you'll be encouraged. Thank you so much for the way you bless our lives. And worship, we primarily think about it being for you, and it is, and that's what it's about. But there's also that blessing that we receive back, coming together as a body and being able to worship together. And we're encouraged in our faith, and it helps us to be strong. Stronger in our faith when we come together. So we thank you also for that, and we praise you for how you use this time in our lives to really encourage our hearts. And we pray that we will honor you. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Throughout our lives, we can expect times of struggle, times of trial. But we know that the Holy Spirit can empower us through those times. I love the lyrics of this next song that say, "The night is dark, but I am not forsaken, for by my side the Savior will stay. So I labor on in weakness and rejoicing." And why can we do that? How can we do that? Because in our need, His power is displayed. I love how that line's written in this song. I have plenty of weaknesses. People that know me best are well aware. Mom and Dad, nothing. Okay. My what? No, I won't put you on the spot. I have plenty of weaknesses. We all do. But the Lord keeps reminding me that this is how His power, the power of sanctification, of our spiritual growth, the power of His light in contrast with darkness, His power to change lives can be displayed. Through our weaknesses, His power can be displayed. Not because we have a better grasp or any sort of a grasp on our own lives, but because He has a grasp on our lives whenever we make the decision to follow Christ. In 2 Corinthians chapter 12, Paul's talking about his struggles, his weaknesses. Just prior to this verse that we'll read here in a second, he's saying that he pleaded with the Lord three times to remove this from him. And here's what Paul says then: "But he said to me, 'My grace is sufficient for you. My power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly of my weaknesses, so that the power of Christ may rest upon me.'" I mean, praise God that we are not alone in our weaknesses and in our struggles. So let's stand together. Let's worship the God that works through our weakness. Please sing with us.
Now to give. Jesus, for he has said that he will bring me home. And day by day, I know he will renew me until I stand with joy before the throne. To this I
yeah. amazing love. How can it be? Cause you, my King, would die for me. Amazing love, I know it's true. And it's my joy to honor you in all I do. In all I do, I honor you.
Before I pray, make sure this mic is working okay. I think we're good. Hopefully it works. Mic cut in and out. If not, I'll switch to another mic. Father God, we thank you and praise you for this morning. We thank you for the opportunity to worship you. You are our King, Father. We are here to be led by your Spirit. We are here to be filled with your Spirit. Speak to us this morning. We pray that our thoughts, our hearts would be directed towards you and it would be pleasing and honoring to you, our King. I give this prayer in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. Children, you are dismissed. Miss Erin and Miss Jenny are over here, and Miss Jerry are over there on that side. So some of you were in ABF class this morning when I taught, and you perhaps noticed that I had a little extra bit of energy this morning and enthusiasm in the class, taking some non-drowsy medication. And so I find myself a little bit more energetic, a little more hyped up this morning, talking a little faster. I'll try to calm that down and slow down a little bit. It's great to be back from Greece. Many of you have asked about the trip that we had there. Commercial announcement, June 9th, we will do a little thing in the multi-purpose room at 6 o'clock where we kind of tie things together. But let me just say this from the outset, just briefly as to what I learned or we learned over there. The church in the first century faced some enormous challenges, and I don't think we have a full realization and comprehension of what that is all about. Some of the challenges of social immorality, views of life after death, Greek mythology, Roman mythology, and here Paul comes in, he's talking about a risen person that comes back from the dead to a culture that is, you know, has all this different perspective of the afterlife, false religions, but I think one of the most important things that boiled out was the fellowship of the church. And how important fellowship was to the early church in difficult times, and how fellowship is still important to the church today. So hopefully you'll have an opportunity to join us on that night, and we'll kind of make a connection there between the things that we saw through some pictures, as well as helping to make the biblical text come alive to you. Several months ago, we began this series in the Gospel of Matthew, and I told you that Matthew has five discourses in it. There are five critical discourses or sermons or teachings with respect to what Jesus does. We spent several weeks going over the Sermon on the Mount. And in that sermon, what Jesus tells his listeners, those that have come to hear him that day, is that this is what a citizen of the kingdom of God looks like. This is what a kingdom citizen looks like. And we see that in chapters 5 through 7. You see the rest of those on the screen there before you. Today, we're going to continue. Now, Pastor Rudy started us last week with the second of the discourses, the commissioning or sending of the 12. So here in chapter 10, if you want to turn in your Bibles there, that would be great. There's Bibles in the pew rack in front of you. We'd like to use those. He's telling his disciples, okay, in the Sermon on the Mount, I told you this is what a kingdom citizen looks like. In chapter 10, he says, okay, now it's go time. Now it's time to go and time to do. And the message that he sends his 12 out is this. tell the people that the kingdom of heaven is at hand. The kingdom of heaven is at hand. First, let them know that when you say the kingdom of heaven, what you mean is that the Messiah that they have looked for and longed for, the coming king, the Messiah, is now here. He's with them. The second thing that the kingdom of heaven indicated, and he was telling them that it's at hand, is that you're going to see the kingdom of heaven now flow through the followers of Jesus. You're going to see the kingdom characteristics and the kingdom power and the kingdom authority flow through the followers of Jesus. Those that would accept him and who he is and embrace the king's authority and live in his ways would be citizens of the kingdom. Now remember, in the Sermon on the Mount, what Jesus helped them to understand was this. There's a common misunderstanding, he says. You think that because you're Jews and because you know Abraham, because you're Moses and your lineage and your offspring and all that, because you're of this particular race, this group of people, that you're automatically kingdom citizens. And Jesus says, you're not. You're not. He says, following the law isn't enough. And you think that being a good Jew is going to be enough. And it's not. He says, not only do you need a king to lead you, but you need a savior that will permanently redeem you from your sins. One who would take away all of the guilt and the sin that they had experienced. Here's the thing. What you're about to hear this morning is vitally important to you here in your community, in your life today. Listen carefully. It has always been God's plan to show his kingdom, his son, and the plan of redemption to bring people into his kingdom through everyday, regular, ordinary people like you and me. It's always been his plan to show his kingdom, to reveal his kingdom, to reveal the redemption of his son of Jesus Christ through people just like us. And he empowers his followers and prepares them to do just that. That is, go and make disciples. Your purpose is to represent Jesus, the King, in your world today. That is our purpose, to represent Jesus as King. Tomorrow, when you go to your Memorial Day picnic, your purpose is to represent the King at that picnic. When you take your kids to school on Tuesday and you drop them off and you're traveling in the car with them, your purpose is to represent King Jesus to your children when you're taking them to school. When you go back to work, your purpose is to represent the King, the redeeming King, at work when you return. Now, as I said, Pastor Rudy started us in chapter 10. The second of Jesus' sermons. He kicked that off last week. And in chapter 10, the first four verses, what you see is Matthew records for us the 12 followers. He writes the names and records the names of the 12 disciples that they are being sent out to their communities and to the world. You'll notice that he includes Judas in the 12. The one that betrayed Jesus with a kiss, ratted him out, turned him over to the authorities. He puts Judas's name in there. I think the reason he does that is, you know, you can do a lot of good and great things and still not be in fellowship or relationship with Jesus Christ. Remember Matthew 7, end of the Sermon on the Mount? Not everyone who says, Lord, we did all these great things for you, not all of them will be in the kingdom. Jesus says, depart from me, you workers of lawlessness. In verses 5 through 15, though, Jesus gives them some instructions. He says, listen, I'm going to send you out. Here's some instructions for you, some things for you to do and not to do. First, you go only to the Jews. Go only to the Jewish communities. Don't go to Gentiles. Your message, the kingdom of heaven is at hand, goes only to the Jews at this time. Jesus wanted his followers and the people to clearly understand, to be very, very clear, that he is the Messiah. They are looking for the fulfillment of prophecy. That's what they're looking for, the coming Messiah. Go only to the Jews and tell them and show them that I am the Messiah. Also, quite frankly, the Gentiles don't have a background to understand what Jesus is talking about. They wouldn't understand the prophecy. Now, in time, Jesus will send them and they will go to the Gentiles. But for now, he wants his message to be perfectly clear. I am the promised prophetic Messiah, and he wants to make sure the Jewish people understand that. He says also, I want you to go and represent me by healing the sick. You're going to heal the sick, raise the dead, cleanse the lepers, cast out demons. You're not just going to go out there and talk. Teaching is important, and they will do that. The kingdom of heaven is at hand. Oh, let me show you, because the king has empowered me to heal. The king has empowered us to remove demons. You don't need compensation for your work, Jesus tells them. It's good work, it's important work, but you don't need compensation. You've been given it freely. Freely give it to other people. You don't need any extra money, any food. You don't need a lunch pail. You don't need any extra clothing. You don't need to rent a room. You don't need to even find lodging when you go there. Jesus says, I've called you to do this. I will empower you and provide you with everything that you need to complete my mission for you. One last thing. Jesus tells him one last thing. Before you guys go, not everybody is going to be eager to hear your message. Here's what he told him. And if anyone will not receive you or listen to your words, shake off the dust from your feet when you leave that house or town. Not everybody is going to listen to you. You go, you be faithful, you preach the word, the kingdom of heaven is at hand, do the miracles, but not everybody is going to like what you have to say. Do your job, share my teaching. If they discard your words, if they reject you, you are not responsible. The idea here of shaking the dust off, it basically is symbolism, means that their choices don't stick to you. Now, in that cultural time, when you walked around with sandals and sweaty, the dust would come up and stick to you. That's what Jesus, shake the dust off. Their decision, their determination, their decision to reject you is not your fault. It doesn't stick. Shake the dust off of your feet as you go. If you want a common everyday phrase, think, I wash my hands of this. You go, you're faithful, you teach, and you wash your hands of it. The disciples are to represent Jesus. What does that look like? What does it look like to represent Jesus? That's what I've told you that we are to be doing. So let's look at the scripture and see what we learn from it with respect to representing the Lord and Savior. Jesus has just told them, I want you to go. I'm empowering you to heal people, cleanse people of leprosy, raise people from the dead. I don't know, but if I were one of the 12, I'd be looking for the first dead person to go to, right? I mean, I'd want to go to the cemetery and say, okay, Jesus said, I can raise people from the dead. He's empowering me to do this. I don't know about you, but that's what I would want to be doing. I would want to go. And Jesus says, well, wait a minute. Before you go rushing off, before you accept this mission, let me tell you. Behold, I am sending you out as sheep in the midst of wolves. So be wise as serpents and innocent as doves. The disciples may be all pumped up to go out there and do the work of Jesus and show this power that the king has given them. But Jesus wants them to know right out of the gate, you could very well be rejected. People are going to deny you. People are going to persecute you. Behold, persecution will come, he says. Be smart about it. Jesus reminds them that this persecution will come. He doesn't want his disciples in this new mission, this new endeavor to go out. He doesn't want them to be caught off guard. Again, the Greece trip was truly awesome. But one of the things that made the trip so good was that we knew some things to anticipate. We knew some things to expect. Brant did an excellent job of showing us things that we need to expect and prepare for. Like the fact that your blow dryers, ladies, they don't work the same way in Greece as they do in the United States. That's an electrical plug. That's what you use to plug into the wall, into the outlet in Greece to charge your phone. If we didn't know that that was coming, if we didn't know that it was like that, we're going to go over there with our chargers, you know, the little two-prong chargers, flat things, stick them in the wall, but it's not going to work because that's the outlets that they have. Brant warned us ahead of time. The other thing is they're on 220 over there, right, Brant? We use 110 here, so you need these little transformers to reduce it from 220 down to 110, or your blow dryer starts to fry in your hand, your hair catches on fire, and ladies, you don't want that. But Brant prepared us for that. We knew in advance what to expect. Jesus does the same thing here. Listen, you guys, it's not all going to be rainbows and puppy dogs. People aren't going to like what you have to say out there. Things might get rough, and it's going to start with the religious leaders. Here's what he says. Beware of men, for they will deliver you over to courts and flog you in their synagogues. Their own Jewish leaders and teachers may very well have them, prison terminology here, thumped, so to speak, flogged, beaten, imprisoned. Expect it, he says. Anticipate it. Know that this might happen. We clearly see this in Acts chapter 4. As the early church begins to grow and expand, the disciples are brought before the religious leaders. They're teaching about this resurrected Jesus, and they're brought before the religious leaders. The disciples are beaten and punished for speaking the truth about Christ. Jesus also tells them, listen, not only your religious leaders, but there's government authorities and government officials. You'll be dragged before governors and kings before my sake to bear witness before them and the Gentiles. Again, Luke records in Acts chapter 12, verses 1 through 4, that Herod found that he could really earn some good points with the Jews if he had James executed, which is what he did. And when things really started to go for his side and he really started to gain popularity, he figures, let me arrest Peter as well. And so he does, and Peter is miraculously freed from jail. Acts chapter 16, Paul's in Philippi. You remember the story, there's a girl that's following him around filled with a demon, and she could predict the future. And her owner received an awful lot of money of the skills and abilities of this girl being able to prophesy and predict the future. Paul casts the demon out of this girl, so now his source of income, his slave girl, is useless. And so he creates this big scene, and Paul is thrown into the prison at Philippi. We had an opportunity to see that very prison where Paul was most likely held on our trip. Notice there's a purpose for the persecution. Jesus says, you could be called before the kings and before the government leaders and governors for the purpose of bearing witness before them, the Gentiles. This is going to be an opportunity for you to share about the kingdom in front of these leaders. The word that Jesus uses here is witness. Do you know we get our modern day word martyr from this term witness? Jesus is telling us, you're going to be witnesses, and it very well could cost you your life. I just want you to know what you're getting into. I just want you to know beforehand that this could cost you everything. But he also says you could receive persecution from your family. Brother will deliver brother over to death, and the father his child, and children will rise against parents, have them put to death, and you will be hated by all of my name's sake. You see, the pressure of persecution was great. Families could lose their source of income, their homes, they could be arrested. And so there was a lot of pressure to point the finger at other people. Yeah, those Christians, those Jesus worshipers, they're over there, they're over there. Families were giving up their own brothers and sisters and parents. And they were being arrested. Businesses were destroyed. To keep yourself clear of Roman arrest and Jewish punishment, they would often give up their own family members. But in the light of this, though, in all of that, Jesus gives them some very important guidance in verses 19 and 20. Now, here's what he says to them. When they deliver you over, do not be anxious how you are to speak or what you are to say. For what you are to say will be given to you in that hour. For it is not you who speak, the Spirit of your Father speaking through you. This is a very, very powerful truth to claim. Jesus says, when you're brought before these authorities and you're questioned about your faith and about this Jesus and being the King, the Holy Spirit is going to provide you the words to speak. You don't have to worry about defending yourself. The Holy Spirit is going to be filling within you and speaking through you. Notice what Jesus says, and this would shock his disciples. And again, to us it may not be so shocking, but in that culture, in that day, Jesus says it will be the Spirit of your Father in heaven speaking through you. To the typical Jew, the people that God spoke to are Abraham, Isaac, the prophets, Moses. Jesus is telling his everyday followers, you're going to be filled with the Holy Spirit. And when that happens, it's God the Father's words speaking through you. This would be earth-shattering to them, that they would have that type of relationship before God, that they would be able to speak his words. Ever there at work, hypothetical situation, and somebody starts to talk about the Bible or religion, or they ask you about your faith. Maybe a topic comes up and you're talking about morality or some social, ethical, moral situation that's going on in our culture. And that topic comes up and all of a sudden your hands start to get a little bit sweaty. You know, you feel like you're ready to say, well, the Bible says, or Jesus said in the... And you're right ready to do that, and all of a sudden your mouth gets dry and your hands start to sweat. You're not exactly sure what to say. It's then that the Holy Spirit will provide you with the words to speak to that individual or those individuals the truth of the word of Jesus Christ in Scripture. The disciples of Jesus are to be like Jesus, he goes on to tell them. Jesus is not asking them to do something or experience something that he himself has not experienced. Jesus isn't saying, listen, I'm sending the 12 of you out. I'm going to stay back here. You're all now Jesus supersized. You're going to do things. That's not what he's saying at all. Jesus has experienced and will experience the same things that they do. The rejection, the hurt, all of that. He's committed and done the miracles that they are going to do. He says it's enough for the disciple to be like his teacher and the servant like his master. If they called the master of the house Beelzebul, how much more will they malign those of his household? The disciples don't outrank the teacher and the slave doesn't outrank the master. It's enough to be like the master. It's enough to be like the teacher. But let's be perfectly clear. Jesus, according to the religious leaders, they said he does these miracles because he's empowered by Satan. And if they said that about me, they're going to say the same thing about you as my followers. Disciples, followers of Jesus, representatives of the King, it's enough for us to be like him. Third thing that Jesus tells them, do not fear. So have no fear of them, for nothing is covered that will not be revealed, or hidden that will not be known. What I tell you in the dark, say in the light, and what you hear whispered, proclaim on the housetops. They must speak the truth. Sometimes the disciples would go out and they would speak the truth of Jesus and really not even know what it meant. Jesus would tell them that this is the case, and they would go, well, here's what Jesus said. Do you understand? Well, I really don't get it, but one day they would. When the resurrection and the crucifixion would take place in the resurrection, it would all become clear to them. Their responsibility was to speak the truth. Jesus says, some of the things I've told you privately, it's okay now. Speak them boldly from the rooftops. Oftentimes, Jewish homes had flat roofs. They'll make great places for them to go up and stand and speak to the people. He says, what I told you in secret when we huddle together, it's now okay to proclaim to everybody. Do it from the rooftops. Speak it loudly. Speak it boldly. He goes on to say, and do not fear those that kill the body, but cannot kill the soul. Rather, fear him who can destroy both soul and body in hell. Listen, this is very clear confirmation that there is life after death. If you're looking for something to pin your hopes on, that there's life after death, that there is something after we die, Jesus says it right here. But catch it, don't miss it. He's telling them that there's a greater death, a more detrimental death, a more serious death than our physical bodies. He's saying, yes, you can physically die, and there are people out there, men can kill the body, but beware, God is one who can destroy both body and soul. Spiritual death far exceeds the physical death that all of us will encounter. So long as we have a proper fear of God and a right perspective of eternity, Jesus says, you don't have to fear anyone. No government leader, no religious leader, no family member that persecutes you. As long as you have eternity in mind and that your soul is eternal and God the Father is going to preserve it, you're on your way. Finally, Jesus tells him, you are a prized possession of God. He's attentive to the sparrow. You are created by God. You are deeply loved by him so much that he would send his son, Jesus Christ, to die for you. He says, you are of great value, he tells his followers. Before you go, make sure you understand that you are of significant value to God the Father. I coached a lot of girls basketball, boys basketball, baseball years ago. One of the things that was always tough was posting the cut list. You know what the cut list is, right? Okay, the cut list determines who the coach feels is best to represent the school on the varsity level. I mean, that's what sports is about, varsity sports and schools, representing your classmates in your school, your community through baseball, basketball, volleyball, whatever case may be. But sometimes the coach has to make hard decisions and post a cut list. I can remember everybody gathered around outside the office, and I would have to go out and hang up the list. Here's the guys or girls that made the varsity. These are on the junior varsity team. These didn't make either team at all. So I ask you, as a representative of the King, are you making his cut list? Are you and I making his cut list? Are we representing him well? Are we representing him the way that we should be? Here's what he says in verses 32 and 33. So everyone who acknowledges me before men, I also will acknowledge before my Father who is in heaven. But whoever denies me before men, I also will deny before my Father who is in heaven. Jesus made his cut list. The 12 were on it. Let me give you 5 points to take away as we get ready to close here today. 5 points to take away. One, his disciples that represented him, they didn't go alone. They worked together for support and encouragement. He sent them out in twos. Their giftedness blended together to produce the right outcome. We as a church collectively represent Jesus Christ at our place of employment. We represent Jesus Christ in our community. We, Martinsburg Grace Brethren Church, represent Jesus Christ and the King cross-culturally in other countries. You saw that this morning as these two guys are going over to Africa. That is why Jesus told us that unity is so important. We can't represent the King if we're unable and unwilling to get along with each other. We can't represent Jesus properly if we're unable to get along with each other. Reconciliation is vitally important. We need to be unified as a church. The second thing, they didn't just talk. When these guys went out, they had the power to do. Cast out demons, heal the sick, raise the dead. we too are called to do. So often in the Gospels we read that Jesus was filled with compassion. He would see this group of people and he would say he had compassion, or he was moved with compassion. Inevitably, after you see that Jesus was moved with compassion, he takes action. He does something to relieve the pain, the suffering. Meeting the physical and emotional needs of others provides us with a platform to share Jesus. When you help or serve your neighbor, when you feed the poor, when you assist other individuals cross-culturally, you're setting the platform to share the gospel of Jesus Christ with them. Third, as we've already mentioned, the disciples, they knew what to expect. Persecution is going to come. If you don't like rejection and you want to be welcomed and accepted by others, this is going to be a difficult job for you representing Jesus. See, if you're going to play on his team, it's going to require sacrifice. It's going to require suffering. By nature of what Jesus is asking us to do, to represent him, to tell others that they are sinners, people are going to be offended. Our society today is easily offended. You use the wrong pronoun, they get upset, they're offended. You drive a V8 gas-powered vehicle, they're offended. You drink your McDonald's drink through a straw, they're offended. Anything and everything seems to offend people nowadays. Well, let's face it, the gospel is offensive because it points out sin. The teachings of Jesus are going to directly rub against the truth of the world. The world has created its own truth to fit their needs, and Jesus' truth is going to be offensive. Don't be surprised when it's rejected, when you're rejected. The gospel is offensive. Fourth, God calls and God provides. God calls and God provides. Hudson Taylor, missionary to inland China, said this: God's will done in God's way will not lack God's supply. God's will done in God's way will not lack God's supply. And don't just think in material terms here. God is going to supply you with the giftedness and the power and the strength and the information, the words, the intelligence that you need to do what he's called you to do. Our job is to be faithful in representing the King. Finally, Jesus sent out those that knew him well. How well do you know Jesus? Remember the Sermon on the Mount again. Jesus didn't send all of them. He sent the 12. He commissioned this small group, this group of individuals that intimately knew him. Can you and I say the same? What's the status of your relationship with the King? What does this look like? Are you growing in relationship with him? To represent the King, you need to know him. You need to have a relationship with him, and you need to be a loyal servant of the King. One last connection to Greece. No sermon that involves Greece would forget or not have Alexander the Great in it, so let me give you an illustration. Alexander the Great was the king of Macedonia, of Greece, 356 to 323 BC. Legend has it that Alexander approached a city to conquer this city as his kingdom spread, and the city was surrounded by a great wall. So he comes up to the wall and he yells to the ruler inside, "Hey, I want to talk to the ruler inside this wall." And so the king of that city comes out and stands on the top of the wall. Alexander says, "You need to surrender." The king, standing up on the wall, looks down. He says, "I'm not going to surrender. One, your army's much smaller than mine, and there's no way you're going to take this city by force." Alexander offered him a demonstration. So all the people in the city come out, and they're standing on the wall, and the king's standing on the wall. Alexander says for his men to line up single file, about face, turn, and march, as he sends them straight to a cliff. The first man marches by his orders of the king and goes off the cliff. Second one, third, fourth, off the cliff. The 12th one goes, and the king says, halt. Boy, aren't you glad that 13th, can you imagine what he's thinking? That 13th guy? Seeing the soldiers' dedication, their loyalty, their boldness, their obedience to their king, the king inside the city surrendered immediately. As Ryan and Celeste come, we have to remember, to war against the evil and the power of the sin in this world, we're kingdom citizens. We need to be disciples of Jesus. We must be dedicated and loyal and obedient to the cause of Christ. Dr. Joseph Stoll, in his book, Jesus Nation, says this: we courageously live to support each other in the face of forces that are far stronger than the strongest of us, yet are already defeated for us. We must know and believe that the victory is already won, and live, act, and speak in confidence that the victory is already won. Go and represent the King. Father God, thank you and praise you for this morning. Thank you for your word. I pray that we will be faithful today, tomorrow, and the subsequent days to represent you as King, to represent you as the Messiah, to know that the battle is already won. Satan is already defeated. He was defeated at the cross, and it was sealed at your resurrection, Father. Give us the power, the boldness to proclaim from the rooftops that you are the Messiah, you are the Son of God, that you are our Redeemer. I give this prayer in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior and King. Amen.
Let's stand together and sing.
I was sinking deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore, buried deeply stained within, sinking to rise no more. But the master of the sea heard my despairing cry. From the waters lifted me, now safe am I. Love lifted me, love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me, love lifted me, love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me. All my heart to him I give, ever to him I'll cling. In his blessed presence live, ever his praises sing. Love so mighty and so true merits my soul's best songs. Faithful, loving service to him belongs. Love lifted me, love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me, love lifted me, love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me. In danger, look above, Jesus completely saves. He will lift you by his love out of the angry waves. He's the master of the sea, billows his will obey. He, your Savior, wants to be saved today. Love lifted me. Love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me. Love lifted me. Love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me. Love lifted me. Nothing else could help. Love lifted me. Love lifted me. Love lifted me. When nothing else could help. Love lifted me.
Close this morning. We want to encourage you to check out our follow-up resources online. One of our follow-up questions that you'll find there is, what are some of the ways that Jesus encourages his followers in the face of suffering in this text? In the passage we just studied, study that for yourself. Dig deeper into that. Dig deep and look for at least 5 ways that Jesus encourages his followers in the face of suffering. So we encourage you to follow up on the website or on the Church Center app as you head home this morning. Let's pray together. God, we thank you that we are not alone in the face of suffering. We thank you that we have you to follow, you to lead us, you to lean on. Help us to take the challenge seriously, to dig deeper into your word this week. Help us to have good conversations about that and to draw closer to you and make that light of yours obvious to others. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Thanks for joining us. You're dismissed.